reopen, so please.
Okay. Okay, thank you, of course, of all of the invitation. It's a pleasure to be present here for street theory. It should be clear from the beginning that street theory is a very vast subject and has tens of thousands of papers over the last 25 years. The subject is completely possible to give some coverage in a few hours lectures. So I'm going to be a very sort of superficial cursory, and so I try to just convey the main ideas, and when I guess it's a sort of pictorial form, I present many pictures, and sort of just the verbal statements, and a lot more hooks. Okay. So I will try to avoid as many formulas as I can, just try to convey the main ideas. And it's of course clear that I cannot really understand all this in any detail in this way. So I'm happy if you just take out some sort of basic messages of this, if you just get some general impression of what street theory is about. Now I have in principle four lectures, which is a bit too much for what is cool. And I just plan to see how far I can get, and probably we have to skip that in the last lecture, so I shorten it. It deals with applications and sort of, theoretical experiments and so on. That's maybe not so interesting as compared to the other lectures where I really try to explain the basic ideas of string theory. So let me start very elementary here with motivation and present the sort of basic construction of string theory in 10 dimensions. Today, I hope also I will be able to say some words of the second part today, namely concerning compactification of these things, 10-dimensional theories to lower dimensions, which brings an enormous extra amount of complexity. Essentially, all the problems of string theory deal with this compactification. Use your predictability and the general structures in which I was asking for copy. So probably get somewhere today, somewhere out of this lecture, and then tomorrow we come to more modern developments like non-perturbative qualities, which revised the subject maybe 15 years ago, having to do with non-perturbative effects. Also some influence on just because of mitigation theories and so on. And as I say, if there's time for the last lecture, then I can also cover some limitations of these ideas. So let me start very, very elementary, but briefly on where things are really located, sort of conceptually or energetically. We have atomic physics associated with some length scale, and we have nuclear physics. Then we have proton neutrons, we have quarks, these are the constituents of the nucleons. This is sort of what is captured by the field of particle physics, and that is related to some length scale, which is sort of the current experimental bound, which is in total of minus 18 meters. And the superstrings are really many, many, many orders of magnitudes on a smaller scale, really outside of experimental reach directly. And there's another field of pillarstone of theoretical physics, which is general relativity. And string theory, however, has a lot to do with general relativity. So in a way, they may be viewed as a bridge between particle physics and GR. So this is what really the physical appeal of strings is. They really form the bridge. They should unify these different fundamental fields of physics. So a few words on particle physics and the standard model. You probably have heard lots of lectures about this already last week. Well, there are sort of some ingredients, some building blocks, and then we have big actions, electromagnetic detections, strong interactions, is carried by sort of force fields, by gauge fields, from W bosons and gluons, and these act on all, provide the direction between the fundamental matter fields, that is, the electrons, so we should have the electrons, muons, and so on, and it works. And these things are packaged in a certain neat way. Actually, there are three copies of this structure. They are called three generations. So there's a repetitive structure here, which is very stunning. I'm not really understanding what it is. Nevertheless, these ingredients together with a rather than together a set of rules, the rules of quantum field theory, the rules how to do computations, how to compute scattering amplitudes. All of this together builds a so-called standard model, which really allows to do very accurate predictions and really fits the experimental data extremely well. So the standard model is in a way the most precise theory that we have of all nature. If you just consider the electromagnetism, the computations, the test list, computing corrections, quantum corrections to G minus 2, this magnetic moment, and so on, is produced with size which are really accurate for right about 10 orders, 10 digits. So this is an extremely well tested and accepted theory. Now, however, there are deficiencies of theoretical nature. Namely, first of all, the structure looks very ad hoc. You know, why do we have these generations? Why do we have quantum and levels? Why do we have this kind of gauge interactions? But on top of this, there's also the question of whether wise parameters of this theory means gauge coupling constant. What is the strength? The mass terms, the quark masses, these parameters. So where are these coming from? So there's something like 25 parameters, and so on, that will take different values. So what has to hear us? Why did we take these values? Then there's a gauge hierarchy. This means there are vastly different scales. For instance, scales in the direction, so really varying of 100 GB, roughly speaking. Then one has a much larger scale, as a simplification scale, or the Planck scale of gravity. There's an enormous difference, and it's known, of course, in a physical system. If there are two sub-pieces which are so characterized by two different scales, so there's an interaction between them. The higher scale influence and the lower one, those strong corrections, in a way, destroys the lower scale. So this is called, this is a problem of stability under quantum corrections. So how can this be that this small scale of the interaction is not ruled by quantum interactions? This has to do with the problem of renormalization. Many diagrams in quantum field by diversion and renormalize and so on. And one traditional remedy of this problem was to introduce supersymmetry, which is a symmetry between bosons and fermions. And in this was just invented because of the following property. Namely that the quantum corrections tend to cancel out, or at least reduce the leading singularities, so these hierarchy problems are sort of more natural, so one can really understand why such difference, why this ratio of these different scales is preserved under quantum corrections. But on our conceptual level, we are not on a level asking why do we have issues like QCD, H2.4, and so on. A more deeper problem is really related to quantum gravity. The standard model, as such, as a model of particle physics, does not contain gravity. And if one applies the standard quantum field rules of quantum gravity, gravity or propagators, trying to compute scattering amplitudes involving gravitons, loops, then I find divergences, which are per se not really unusual, but they are of a very special bad kind, namely they are not recognizable. The stuff here is not really defined. It looks, and there are recent attempts to argue that this problem actually doesn't exist, namely that the high energy behavior of gravity might be much better than this idea. So this is a bit of an open issue, but it doesn't really matter because this is anyway only one manifestation of an apparent really deep clash between quantum mechanics and general relativity. Roughly speaking, this is because GR deals with coordinates with nice geometrical quantities like position coordinates, x. And in quantum field theory, these things become operators and fuzzy, unsharp, Heisenberg relations and so on. So, just from the very logic of these ingredients, I mean, it's clear that there's a clash between these two. In particular, and this is very clearly also in the context of black holes, where sort of one applies naive quantum mechanical rules to these black hole classical solutions in GR, and immediately runs into very deep conceptual problems like information loss and so on. So from that, it was clear since a long time that really new concepts are needed to somehow marry GR and quantum mechanics, and this is really what string theory provides. And in view from this perspective, you might say that as the unification of particles in three directions is in a way a byproduct of this. This is also how I see it. The main feature of string theory for me would be really this combining quantum mechanics and GR in a consistent way, and it is also the feature of this particle physics in a natural way. Okay, so what is string theory? Well, actually, it's hard to define what it really is, but let's start historically and naively. So the idea is we have very tiny oscillating loops, or maybe open strings, which are ends. And but this sounds ad hoc, and I could ask whether it might be something else, pink elephants or something. But as you see, there's a reason for this. But this is sort of the first naive mistake that I can make here. And they are very tiny, namely the size of an oscillation level space is sort of given by the constant, which is a characteristic of the gravity, which is extremely high. So the excitation spectrum looks like this, roughly speaking. The excitations repeat infinite times. The first excited level is like the Planck scale at 10 to the 19 GeV, which is extremely high, much higher than any accelerator possibly reached today. So all of what we call particle physics, high energy physics actually, is low energy physics in the string theory, namely they're all attained to the so-called zero-mode center. So when people say string theory quarks and leptons and so on are oscillations like this of a string, this is actually not accurate picture, because these are oscillations will always be excited states. The particle physics we sort of aim for is a zero mode sector where it has to do with constant motion of these strings, maybe higher dimensions and so on, but not really excited modes. The next, so becoming a little bit more technical, in particle physics we talk about scattering, which is in terms of eigenvalues. Level, particles collide, generate the repeated one, and then split up again if you want. Or we have some root diagrams where runs around virtual particle, antiparticle runs around the loop. And string theory, these particles become really little strings. And when they sort of generate these processes, they really trace out two dimensional surfaces, so called world sheet. Particles trace out space-time world lines, things world sheets. The same thing for loop diagram. And so I intuitively understand that thing to be very, at least by Jarvis string theory, is tied to field theory on these Riemann surfaces. Riemann surfaces are just was a possible two-dimensional surfaces with some holes or maybe not holes. Yeah. So, roughly speaking, from this perspective, string theory can be viewed as a so-called conformal field theory. I'll explain this later. Living on these Riemann surfaces, fields X, for example, they can be free fields. They might not be interacting in two dimensions. And they represent the embedding coordinates of the string in space time. So X maps a two-dimensional coordinate Z on D-dimensional space time. D is the space time in which these things move. And a first glimpse of why this would be a sort of interesting is that now how do we describe different fields in space time, like gravitons, like H fields, like Higgs bosons, and so on. And they're actually just are different combinations of the same building blocks. Yeah? So we have some big bosons in two dimensions, labeled with some indices, they might not be interacting at all, yeah? But just combining them in different ways. We have left moving this with unholomorphic, kind of holomorphic pieces, depending on the two-dimensional coordinate. Just by mere combination, we can generate very different looking fields in the ordinary space. So this already hints at that strings provide an intrinsic unification of particles and interactions. So now one of the biggest miracles and strong points of string theory is the following, and that's more or less the most complicated formula I'm going to show and explain it very detailed. We talk about the effective action, what the string theory is doing when sort of we consider this two-dimensional conformal field theory and put it in sort of two-dimensional space-time and put what's effective action is what kind of effective Lagrangian produces. So I'll start with a two-dimensional theory, a Lagrangian here, divided over two-dimensional coordinates, depends on this two-dimensional field X, if it's then the coupling constant on this, so it's graviton, gauge fields, and so on. Then what does pass integral over this two-dimensional field is an ordinary partition function of pass integral. But as I was saying, these things live with two-dimensional surfaces, which are given by sort of whatever two-dimensional surface you like is something. Human surface is completely specified by topologically by the number of holes it has. So to define this partition function by is to sum over all the Riemann surfaces. So this two-dimensional theory is taken to be on each Riemann surface and sums over this, weighted by a field which is called the Dirac-Bond. And this is nothing but the loop expansion. So this is just the quantum correction. And since the factor here, the Dirac-Bond changes here, power by the number of poles of the Riemann surfaces, this plays the role of a coupling constant. One has the sum over these two dimensional theories living on these Riemann surfaces, and there's a weight factor for each given by the maximum expectation values of the electron. And the outcome of this, so this is just a natural effective action everybody would like. But the non-trivial thing is that in E dimensions, it generates an effective action for these coupling constants, which are gauge field, coupling constants, which is just nothing but the Einstein theory of relativity. So we have usual Einstein Lagrangian here, plus gauge symmetries, depending on the model, plus chiral fermions or whatever you like, plus corrections, higher order corrections, let's say higher terms of powers of the Riemann tensor and so on. But these are also pressed very strongly, namely by inverse powers of this Planck scale. So this means that lower depth and lower energies, this is what we would measure, these terms are very strongly suppressed. And for all practical purposes, this effective action is just, general relativity, plus young history, plus whatever, other things we love a lot. So that we can can start from a two-dimensional, even free theory, just extremely simple rules, and just interface the two-dimensional out, that we obtain this extremely complicated Einstein's relativity, plus other things, and you know, apparently a completely consistent manner. This is the achievement of thinking. This is a big error. So, we will say a few more words about later about the nature of this evaluation expansion, which is sort of the analog of the time and dynamic expansion. Okay? But just before we do this, just let me mention one of the most important features, namely that this expansion has properties, some properties, that are really due to string theory and have no analog to particle theory. This has to do with the discrete parametrization of the surface. You always think to cut sort of one handle apart and rotate the ends and put them back together in. So this means that this map or parametrization, this deconformation of the surface onto itself, this is no analog in particle physics, because in particle physics has just thin particle diagrams that are just, you know, in loops here. They're not any thickness. And these extra symmetries that here we have as is the basis of the consistency of this perturbation expansion, the basis of unitarity and so on. So this is very important, namely that the slit is not just a collection of infinitely many particle theories. It's not so that by just saying, I take particle theories, could one say, okay, I take infinitely many copies, so as to mimic this power of excitations, that would be equivalent to string theory. This is not the case. So let's put what are the consistency conditions, what are the ingredients here? I was saying two-dimensional conformality theory is, you know, what defines string theory, but one has to spell out a bit more precise what the interest is. So what are the rules to make a consistent string theory? So there's always this kind of translation between the two-dimensional properties, between, you know, the fields and the algebra and so on this two-dimensional surface, and to what it corresponds to in the space-time dimensions, which effectively generates. So the statement is that the conformal invariance in the virtue, which is just the invariance under reparametrization of the two-dimensional coordinates. This implies in space-time the general covariance of the Einstein theory plus gauge symmetries, if the gauge is present and so on. As we see in a moment, that works over only if the dimensions are 26. So two-dimensional, the property of conformal invariance ensures consistency of gauge symmetries and gravity e-dimensions. Then modular invariance, this is discrete parametrizations of three-man surfaces, which may be viewed as a discrete analog of conformal invariance. As we see, strongly constrains the spectrum, it ensures the absence of ultraviolet divergences and anomalies, and imposing this conformal invariance on this two-dimensional conformal theory also restricts the cosmic spectrum. Consistent condition, once we impose it, the number of possibilities for what we can do in choosing these two-dimensional views is very much restricted. Then we have also two-dimensional supersymmetry at our disposal. That it actually is necessary to have space-time parameters. But it does not imply that the d-dimensional theory is this is often mistaken that strings or superstrings would imply supersymmetry in space-time. This is completely wrong. Two-dimensional supersymmetry is only necessary if you want to have space-time parameters like quantum leptons. Whether the space-time theory is supersymmetric or not is an extra condition. The consistency, as we will see, requires 10 dimensions. It's supersymmetric.
Can you repeat what you what modular invariance means?
Yes, I will explain a bit more in detail in the next slides.
Just one more quick question. People sometimes say that, you know, if LHCCs, supersymmetric particles,
yeah,
that will be motivation for string theory also.
But
now you are saying that, you know, even if you have two-dimensional supersymmetry, that doesn't necessarily imply low-energy supersymmetry. Okay. So,
there is no strong relationship between strings. This is often missing. It is also biased because most string models on deals are supersymmetric, but just because these are sort of good under control, normalized and so on. But there is no real reason why space time physics would be so very good, because it is not. Okay? Some words about this one from the heat theory. This is two-dimensional heat theory on these Riemann surfaces. The operators, the one-voice operators, find in the right way to describe the operators of the space time is. This is characterized by a stress energy tensor, which is the generator of this conformal oscillations, and it has an operator polar expansion, which can also be written as this Virasoro algebra. This is just the algebra of this Lyapunov representations. This is really the algebra of the theory. And the only thing here is that it is an anomaly, an extra term, which sort of spoils the sort of clean transformation behavior, which is characterized by some Z number, the sort of sense of charge. And say, in the case of the scalar field, the scalar field contributes to the C as one unit. So, a conformal field theory is D bosons contributes to this algebra of the stress tensor, C value of D. But this is not really a string theory by itself, a conformal field theory. There's something more. It may actually start with a path integral, this is called Fourier convection. In a way, it just says that the action is given by the area of this worksheet. This is just written in this one form. It involves this field x, which is sort of the maps of the worksheet to space time. So they have a double meaning. They are Euclid's coordinates of space time, but are fields in two dimensions, it depends on the two dimensional coordinate C. So this is a general covariant expression here. And then one to quantize it, one can do it various ways. One can fix the gauge, for the conformal gauge, and choose a key of one. Then it becomes just a conformal field of scalar fields, E, but this is what we had before. But because of fixing of the symmetries, there's more to it. We have also ghost fields. So if you're familiar with the quantization of gauge theories, it's very similar. One has to put in extra degrees of freedom in order to sort of have fermionic degrees of freedom which cancel out gauge degrees of freedom in the original theory. So this is a very simple system of free fields called B and C. Their central charge with a stress tensor is minus 26. So if you put this together in one theory, namely the ghost plus the other positive matter fields, together should vanish, that implies that we need 26 of these scalar fields. In other words, 26 dimensions. So that's the reason why we have those Bosonian string of dimension 26. Can we move it up a little bit? But never mind, it's not so important. Yeah, okay. No, I think this main thing is already here. Namely, a feature of this is, because of long ordering in this conversation and so on, it turns out that quantum mechanical spectrum doesn't start at mass zero, but it starts at mass minus one. Because of a random shift, and a scalar mass square is minus one is called a tuck. And this means that the theory has an unstable vacuum. Because the starting point of this theory so that it's easily defined, and that will be able to compute some of the types to fit a few events that we can have. So for the bosonic string, there's an infrared instability, there's the vacuum of lead, and this is the natural cosmic space. It's not the right choice. So this is a society mark. But let's go on and come to this modular invariance, which is an important feature. So let's consider the partition function and particle quantum field. Just if I loop diagram, we are going on just a loop like this. Yeah? So we have an evolution here into the number of stages, the propagator. So the partition function is just given by the phase of all the states. This is my TH. It makes it similar but different. Yeah, we have now a donor focus, a donut here instead. Again, we have this kind of revolution to the max age. But we have also another new direction we can rotate here around. Actually, we can here have a spin kind of operator, which is sort of the generator of the rotation in this direction. So the partition function has two parameters, TFS, one is the time. Plus, then we have an extra term, which is periodic and goes sort of the other way. So, these two parameters actually can be packaged together in a complex parameter tau, where the real part is sort of this rotation. And what it is actually the modular parameter for focus. Let's go to the next transparency. So what it really is the focus topologically is nothing but a parallelogram where you identify the opposite sides. So you can always mathematically represent the focus in this way where you put together the opposing sides. Yeah? And then there's a certain shape you can choose. You can tilt this. And the way you tilt this can be encoded by this complex parameter tau, which is just the complexified corporate time plus this balance. And the important thing is that the torus can map back to itself by transformation of this tau. You shift tau by one unit or we invert it or something. And it turns out whenever we do something, we map back to an equivalent torus, which looks the same. So this is a symmetry group of this torus, and this transformation generates so-called modular group, is the T, and all the elements can be. These are the generators of this. Yeah. The statement is of modular events that all the physical amplitudes, the partition function, everything should be invariant under these transformations. So, for example, consider the bosonic spin again. We have this excitation spectrum, some oscillators. Articulation of operators one on the ground state of the zero modes and use a partition function. This is just a combinatorial function, just by counting of how many ways you can reach certain level. In this way, the partition function is given by the sort of dedicated data function, which is a very famous harmonic function in this mathematics. And indeed, this function has good modeling properties. Transforms in a very defined way. So this partition function, C indeed is modular invariant if E is 26 again. So this is in a way a little bit different from the previous argument before we were considering continuous conformal transformations and found the critical dimension of 26. Here we consider the one loop consistency, the consistency of deprimerizations. One loop diagram, we also find E to 26 is necessary condition. So now this, as I was saying before, this condition has no analog in particle physics. Let's just step back and consider what we would be doing if we would be computing the one loop vacuum amplitude in particle physics. So we have already this partition function, which is based. minus t times psi Hamiltonian, and maybe this rotation generator also. So in quantum physics, we just make this Schwinger type of integral 0 to infinity, and well, just plainly integrate this other view of infinity, just namely, so you generate, so also integrate in this tau, which the tau is this complexity, right? Happening as plus my IT, roughly speaking, will integrate over this region here. And so the Hopper time goes from 0 to infinity, and what happens is that at t equals 0, we have ultraviolet divergence because of this measure here, which measure that divergence at t equals 0. So this is the usual ultraviolet divergence in particular. So this would be happening in, say, theories with a scalar. Now, however, it's strictly the situation is different because tau really is the modular parameter of the torus, we should take the symmetries of this torus into account. So, in order, what we have to do is we should not integrate over all this region, but only over this region which corresponds to a single copy of this torus. We were just saying before there are many transformations of this parameter which map the torus to itself or to equivalent parameterization. And if you would integrate over all these values, we would double count or count the torus into many times often. So, what my really has to do is to integrate here only over a sort of fundamental domain of this upper half plane, of this top plane, and it looks like this. Because every other point outside is related by a modular transformation to a point inside, and we would want to count each inequivalent torus point closely once, we just have the strict integration over this domain. And the most striking feature is that this point t equals 0 is not present, it's absent. So this means instinctively ultraviolet divergence cannot appear. So the very reason, the effect of this modular variance, by requiring that sort of each term of the variation expansion is being invariant under this modular transformation, acts as a cutoff, which prevents the theory to be very ultraviolet. And there's a major story. But I have not had time to explain this. It had to do with this lower boundary is curved and not straight. And that ultimately also means that this kind of properties of amplitudes cannot be mimicked or recovered in particle physics. Because in particle physics, you would know more about this torus. Because the latent figure here, it didn't even consist of something. Okay. Oh, a few minutes. Okay.
Can I ask something about this? Like, you chose that fundamental reason as fundamental reason. Is there a physical reason, or can't you have chosen an equivalent region around zero, around ultraviolet?
Yes. Okay. And all the fundamental regions are equivalent, of course. But can you go back one more slide? Yeah. Of course, the usual argument is, oof, you choose one, it doesn't contain zero, but why don't you take one which looks here and it contains zero? Okay, but in this way, you obtain some singularity zero, but the interpretation of this is because if you do this transformation, you do some manipulations. It is sort of, again, a different divergence. So in a way, it's similar to modular transformations. Also a symmetry at 0 to infinity here. And when I'm saying there's no ultraviolet division, there's still something at infinity which is actually there, which is the Tachyon ultraviolet divergence. So, but the proper interpretation is that there is no ultraviolet, no ultraviolet divergence, but there's an infinite divergence of this theory related to these Tachyons. Which anyway also means that the theory is not verified in any other theories and work to superstrings in particular. So the law is strictly the ultraviolet divergences are not possible, but there's still a divergence possible and there are all infinite divergences. sometimes they are physical. For example, the running of the edge button constant is a physical phenomenon. It's coming from the emergence of convergent divergences. So string theory does have divergences, but they can always be interpreted with infinite divergences. Okay? So how much more time do I have? The first 5 minutes are over. So either I go on 10 more minutes for the explaining superstrings, or I do it next time. Next time. Up to you. What was next time?
The last three.
Yeah, there is
one process
that's
also
called
superstrings.
Okay, so let me be brief, and then you say it in two words. So the superstrings just involve two dimensional permanence partition. Two dimensional is actually supersymmetric. And the space, the reason is that the space time permanence, you know, is the square root of two dimensional permanence. So two dimensional permanence has an index mu. Space time vector is the square root of a vector space in a way. So that's way, that's how you generate space time fermions. And they also give a contribution to the center of charge, only 1/2 e. And then they have their own symmetries, the super symmetries, which need to be H fixed and so on. If you extra ghost, then they contribute to plus 11. If you put this together, then the solution of D is 10. So this is the reason why the superstrings have a critical dimension of 10. And the new ingredient really is the spin structures, which are nothing but the boundary conditions of this fermion. If you have a fermion, a Riemann surface, a piece of it, and go on a neck, then the fermion can switch sign. It can go to plus or minus itself. Essentially, because all observables at the end are the bilinear fermions. So we never see this. The sign of a fermion is not observable, but still, it's the boundary condition in the measure of fermion. It's periodic or anti-periodic. So on a general Riemann surface, you have now something which is called a speed structure, which is just information about how each fermion transforms or about each angle. Does it change the sign or does not change the sign? And the partition functions of these different theories are different. So depending on whether you have a fermion, periodic in both directions, or periodic in one direction, anti-periodic in the other, and so on, these different partition functions, these things are actually called theta functions in a sense. What's the other point? It's not a question of theta, yes. So now they transform differently than modular transformations. This means to obtain a modular invariant two-dimensional theory with fermions, one has to make a choice of what kind of boundary conditions one creates.
How come the fermion, after rotating 360 degrees, go to either minus or plus?
Yeah.
And for the space-time fermions, for space-time you say for fermions it gets a minus sign, for bosons it doesn't. But the fermion you had in the two-dimensional space, it goes to plus or minus.
Yes, yeah, it's undecided. This is a boundary condition. Maybe very undecided.
Ah, okay.
Actually, in two-dimensional, maybe real statistics possible, but this is fraction. So to make a long story short, we can now take these theta functions, these ones, which are called the boundary conditions, and put them together in a string partition function. But there are various combinations one can do. In particular, it has a holomorphic, direct moving, and other holomorphic, left moving piece, this spreadsheet. Depending how you combine things, you obtain different partition functions for different string theories in space, which are called type 2A, B, or heterotic theory, which involves some bosonic piece in addition. So either you have a direct product, this means that the holomorphic, anti-holomorphic, take a split in a way, just cleanly, but you can also think about more correlated functions. So you can have replaced this by a sum of holomorphic times anti-holomorphic pieces. And this is more complicated. Yeah? So these are the canonical theories in 10 dimensions, which are supersymmetric, pattern, 3, and so on. There's a variant, this is just always strange, and I'll discuss it right here. Yeah? And if you make a more non-trivial correlation between this left and right, building blocks, then one can generate a larger variety of interaction strings, but they are typically have no supersymmetry and they have pachyons, one of them does not. So there exists an equal footing, basically, the Kaplan theories are usually accepted, usually people say, oh, there are only these things. No, no, there's like six more other theories in 10 dimensions, which are just not supersymmetry, which arise from differently combined building blocks. So that's the last transparency. This is what we can obtain as final thing for today, namely the list of the supersymmetric string theories in 10 dimensions by combining left and right moving superstrings in S and SR, and then there's a kind of conjugation operation one can flip a spin or down state and so on. So one has also this is bigger or not, it's not this bigger. By combining them in various ways, and can obtain these things, heterogeneous things, like base groups, boson increases, so what these theories have in common is that they have just one dimensional parameter, namely the Hund scale, the string coupling in a way out of time, that's the scale of the strings, that's the only parameter. And then there's another parameter, which is the vacuum expectation value of the dilaton, which is the spring coupling in the sense that the loop expansion is weighted by the powers of this coupling. It's the way this goes after each bar. Yeah. So this is a very different gauge groups and parallel properties and so on. And they are 10 dimensions so far, although it's 4 dimensional. And in the next lecture, I will explain how we can reduce this to four-dimensional theories, which brings in an enormous extra load of complexity.
Any questions or comments?
Please, can you explain what is the dilaton?
Sorry?
Dilaton.
Dilaton, okay. I was saying at the beginning, if I can assemble various field operators in space, and like the graviton or gauge boson and so on, Higgs bosons, by making different combinations of these two dimensional building blocks, here by choosing left and right. But there is one component, namely, assume that you have fields x mu, two dimensional derivative x mu. X mu is the graviton, but the graviton, in a way, it's a symmetric matrix without trace. Yeah? But the trace part, in other words, which is this, the indices are some over, this is a scalar, this is a dilaton. So in a way, in strings, the dilaton is as basic as the graviton. It's just a diagonal, in some sense, a diagonal piece of the graviton.
How can we interpret the tachyon states in the partition functions that you just mentioned?
Yeah.
How can we interpret them?
Okay.
And what's the meaning of making it tachyon free?
Yeah, okay. So a tachyon appears also in field theory. Yeah? If you consider a Higgs potential, say a scalar field theory. And if you define the theory here, if you look at the spectrum of this theory, is, yeah, I mean, then you have a negative mass. Here you have a positive mass. Scalar field expressed positive, but here expressed negative. It means that it's positive,